This video aims to explain the structural architecture of the hippocampus and the transmission pathway of the trisynaptic circuit, all of which are associated with cognitive processes like memory formation. To start with, here is the anatomy of the brain. This is visually and structurally divided into four lobes: the frontal, temporal, parietal, and occipital lobe. Deep within the medial temporal lobe is a set of structures collectively known as the limbic system. We will solely be focusing on the hippocampus, which is one of the structures that make up the limbic system. This is a paired structure, with one found within each cerebral hemisphere. The word hippocampus is Greek for seahorse, as it takes on this shape. It's part of the hippocampal formation, comprising of the parahippocampal gyrus, entorhinal cortex, the subiculum, and the dentate gyrus. The hippocampus has roles within spatial awareness and the conscious recollection and consolidation of declarative memory. These are the types of memories that you can declare, like facts and events, known as episodic memory. Case studies support its role in memory formation, where lesions in the hippocampus have resulted in the inability of patients to form new memories. However, it's important to note that there are many types of memories, each supported by distinct neural systems throughout the brain. For example, non-declarative memory, which includes procedural and habitual learning, is known to be supported by the basal ganglia. Now, let's look further into the trisynaptic circuit, which will explain the flow of information through the structures of the hippocampus. The major sensory input into the hippocampal formation will come in from the entorhinal cortex. This is a bundle of fibers forming the input tract. This will act as a hub in the widespread network for the memory. These bundles of fibers in the entorhinal cortex will project to the granule cells of the dentate gyrus via the perforant pathway. This is the first pathway in the trisynaptic circuit. From here, the dentate gyrus will transmit its signals to the CA3 pyramidal neurons through the MOSI fiber pathway, which is the second pathway of the circuit. These MOSI fibers have dense reciprocal connections which are able to generate new patterns of activity, where one single MOSI fiber can project to around 35 pyramidal cells within the CA3. CA stands for cornu ammonis and helps to divide the hippocampus into four subfields, from CA1 to CA4. This name actually comes from the similarity between the shape of the hippocampus to the ancient Egyptian deity Amun, who has horns of a ram. Then the Schaffer collateral pathway, which is the third pathway completing the trisynaptic circuit, will connect the CA3 neurons to the CA1 Schaffer collateral neurons, where it has the highest concentration of NMDA receptors within the brain. Finally, the CA1 neurons will project to the subiculum, which is considered the major output region for the hippocampus. It will go out to the cortical and subcortical regions. The subiculum not only receives cortical inputs from the entorhinal, pararhinal, and prefrontal cortices, but it sends projections out to the fornix and back out to the entorhinal cortex in order to complete the loop. All of the cells that make up the hippocampus will collectively act as an index. This is similar to how a computer index works, as it's able to retrieve and record the information that is necessary for particular memories. In the case of playing piano or studying, the hippocampal index will retrieve and reactivate all of the distributed parts of the different processing areas associated with that memory. So essentially, the stronger the connections are between these neurons, the quicker you'll be able to recall what you wanted to remember. This is essentially a cortical representation of a memory. Therefore, the hippocampus has to communicate with many distributed regions of the cortex and to collate all of the information from these widespread cortical areas.